Okay, I've proposed this talk being held in English, but to be sure if I'm not able to hold it in German because I'm a native German speaker. So is there anybody who is not able to understand German? So I keep going in English. The talk today is, there's a picture missing. That is it. Mixed realities for web. Few words about me. I'm a technical director at MediaMan in Mainz, Mayence, and I'm responsible for the whole IT and for the web development team, and I'm web developer since 1998, and I'm always interested in open technologies, so I'm a volunteer for Mozilla's Tech Speakers, so I'm speaking about tech topics from Mozilla and for the open web. And if you want to reach me at Twitter, I am Kazarock at Twitter. There is I think it's a rock club in Argentina, which is called Kazarock, so I get a lot of mentions, but that's not me. Enough about me. It's a talk is about WebXR or mixed realities for the web and what we could expect and what we could achieve nowadays. Just two questions. Did you know? The ViewMaster is a device which was invented in 1939, and it was able to show some stereoscopic pictures which had sort of 3D view. So the whole design of head-mounted devices we are using today is based or still nearly the same like the device from 1939, about 70 years, no more, it's not 80 years, it's amazing. So what happens? We've got now the Oculus Rift or other devices like the HTC Vive. The Oculus Rift in 2013 brought us a new kind of VR. So we were able to see really immersive 3D VR experiences. It was a disruption in this whole technology because a consumer could buy it. It wasn't a military technology anymore, it was for consumers. HTC Vive came later, PlayStation VR and so on, and we have the Google Cardboard, which is just to put your handy or mobile phone, English, into your cardboard head-mounted display, and you could experience the 3D world. Really cheap, and everybody has a phone which is capable to play it. And did you know that this device, called Project Headsight, was one of the first augmented reality devices for military purpose? It uses a laser projection, the cube, into the room, and the guy who's wearing it could see it when he look. His view is augmented by this 3D cube with the laser protection. So it's from 1961. So AR isn't new as well as VR isn't new. Now we have the HoloLens or the Magic Leap one, which are still nearly the same devices with the same technology to project something into the room to augment our reality. In 2017 there was some kind of AR revolution because iOS introduced or Apple introduced ARKit. So we were able to have real AR on our mobile phone with plane detection and everything you wanted to use. VR until then was just marker based. We have a marker and we have to find the marker, we see it later. So this was a real revolution. I call it revolution because now we have AR in our pocket, like the Google Cardboard thing. So let's start with VR. short introduction. AR, mobile setup, as mentioned before, this is a cardboard, you have your mobile phone, and you have it on your eyes, and you see this scene. That's all. You're using the sensors in your phone to track where the user is looking. We have the computer-based setup. We have some kind of position sensor, which detects the device and knows where you are in the room. Nowadays, there's a bit more. We have room trackers at the HTC Vive and so on. I think everybody knows it nowadays. The problem until now, until Oculus has this, I think it's Quest, was this was the real virtual reality. We had a lot of cables. This was a problem. I think now it's getting better. How do we detect the how I'm seeing the world? We have XYZ orientation, and we have the position sensor, which detects. We have infrared sensors in the devices, which detects where I am and how far or near I am on my display. And we have other sensors, like our phone has, to detect the rotation of your head. It's basically the same for the mobile setup, except you don't have this position sensor. What do we need? We need a 3D picture. It's kind of obvious. We have two cameras, left eye, right eye, and we have two pictures which are rendered, a bit overlapping, and that's all. And it needs to be fast, because if not, you're getting sick. We have left eye picture, we have right eye picture, and we have to create it, that's all. Now I said this is web, mixed realities for web. This was VR, as it is everywhere. There is something called web VR. They describe it like browser APIs that enable WebGL rendering for headsets and access to VR sensors. So we have access to our whole device and our sensors to use it in our browser. It's shipped in Firefox and Google Chrome. I think you need to activate a flag. So you can use it since, well, I think, half a year now. There are a lot of APIs which we have. This is detecting a display which is attached on my computer. You could set some eye parameters, the position sensor, you could read the position sensor where I am, what is the position sensor measuring, on, what data is the position sensor measuring. And if you want to create, or you want to detect a VR device in JavaScript in a browser, you have a new VR frame data, you get VR display on the navigator object, it's a promise which resolves and giving you displays. You could have more than one display. It turns out most people only have one display attached, so you can use the first you found. And when you found it, you have to create a function to start the VR experience. This is a standard. Those APIs, and they are well documented in MDM or somewhere else, and you could get more information. So I get a rough overview over the API web VR. Drawing a scene when you've detected a device and you're starting your render loop using the request animation frame. What we need to get is frame data. We populate the frame data with initialized before, and we get the pose sensor. So there is the data we are using when the head is rotating, or how near or how far you are away from your position sensor. And with this data, it's the only thing, a little bit WebGL magic, and you may be able to create a VR experience. So you need to use those data and render two pictures of your scene which are slightly overlapped. There are more APIs, things to do, not APIs, because we are in the web. You don't know what browser you have. under your web page. You don't know how fast or how slow is your hardware, and you need to take care of this all. This is like responsive web design. We have different resolutions, and you have to do all those to support a seamless experience. But there are many, many good people in the world who are writing frameworks. Nearly nobody is writing a single page app without a framework nowadays. Most people use Angular, Vue, or React. And for web we have A-Frame. A-Frame is powered by Mozilla, a framework where you could use markup to describe your scene. That's all. And you could deliver it to all devices, even the mobile devices. And they take care about the rendering of your scene in split view or showing it on the real devices. Let's take a look what we have to do. If you want to have a box, we have the A-Frame framework included. We have semantic tags, a scene, a box with an ID, some colors and rotation and scale, and that's it. And we have a skybox, which is gray. So when we want to animate this box, we have an A animation, and we could animate it. This source code results in this view. If I would press this button, I will get the VR rendering for mobile or the attached device. So that's really easy to create some VR. There are many examples which are using A-Frame or which are created from scratch. A good example is 360 Sirius using A-Frame, so you could experience the cruelty of a war. So what is happening there? So you have the chance to do it on your phone, and with the cardboard you will get VR view, and it's very impressive to see those destroyed areas there. Mainly using 360 pictures, but it's still impressive. It's relatively old, this page, but still good. There is a demo from A-Frame, the A-Painter, where you can use the controllers from an HTC Vive or Oculus to paint in the 3D world. So you have a 3D picture. It's a remake of an, I think it's a Google app for the Samsung Gear device. So they remade it in A-Frame for the web. So if you have a browser, you have a device attached, and you're going to this page, pressing the VR button, you are able to paint without installing any software. And there is some serious use cases. Ford uses, in America, uses A-Frame to have an interior view from the new SUV models. So you can experience it in the web via a magic window, and you can swipe and look at the things, or you could dive into it with a Google Cardboard. So I think that's a good use case which shows where web VR is really useful. And last but not least, Pepsi and Google made this little page I don't know which birthday it is from Pepsi. So they're traveling back in time, and you could experience some older vending machines or something. It's cool. Just a gimmick. But it's also, you don't have to install anything. You could experience it as fast as possible. It's great. Yeah. Okay, that's VR. But I said it's mixed realities. But what the hell is mixed reality? So we have at the one end we have the reality, this, and the other side, there's the virtual reality. In the middle of it, we have something like augmented reality. And the mixed reality uses things in the room without overlapping it. It says, let's talk about ARKit. You could detect this plane of the table, you could detect this plane, and you could Position your model behind the table. That's what Magic Leap is able to do. And yeah, the mixed reality. This is a demo from, I think it's the HoloLens, where they're using your furniture to play lemmings. This is mixed reality. So we mixed our reality with some virtual reality. Or a demo from Magic Leap. The R2-D2 isn't real, and no, the projection from R2-D2 isn't real, also R2. So there are different kinds of AR and mixed realities. As said, we had marker-based augmented reality. So we have a marker on our printout, and we could augment some more information. That's pretty old. It was able with Flash and in web browsers early 2000s. We had markerless AR. When the smartphones were coming, we had location sensors. We could detect where the people are and where they are looking. We had a magnet into the phones. And I think Wikitutor were one of the first who made an AR app. So you could stand in Hamburg and you could look around and say, that's the Michel or what else. And you could get some information from Wikipedia. That's why they are called Wikitutor. Then we have tracking based. This means we are detecting surfaces. A HoloLens could detect surfaces horizontally and vertically. Since the, I think it is ARKit 1.5, the iPhone is also able to detect vertical surfaces. And this is a game changer because you could place your object on the surface, go around, and when you come back, it's still there. And this wasn't possible with marker-based AR. Okay, but I've talked about XR. What is XR? It's pretty easy because nobody knows how should we name it. So they decided, let's call it XR. Whatever you want. Whatever you want to say XR, VR, that's everything. And there's WebXR. That's a new API, which is introduced, which has been working on, and there was WebVR. WebVR will be stopped. It will WebXR will be the WebVR 2.0 implementation. Okay, so it's an API for AR and VR. So we are able to detect device. We are able to ask for capabilities of this device, and we could decide if we want to have an AR or VR experience. I can't read my own slides on this because light. it's a step towards to the immersive web. The W3C says, okay, we want the immersive web. They have a big documentation in GitHub. Where you can read what's their vision. And it's not compatible with WebVR. Maybe it's a problem, we will see. And WebVR 2 will become the WebXR device API. So what's the life cycle of a proposed WebXR experience? So this is all those technologies are in beta, they are in flux, they are not ready. You should not use them for production. It is easy as 1, 2, 3 to create a WebXR experience. Step one, you need to ask for access. Could I access this device if you detect one? You need to request the so-called XR session and start the session and allow to start the session. This is an important thing. You have to provide a button to start the session. You could not start a session without user interaction. Within the session, start your render loop with awesome graphics. Okay, easy as 1, 2, 3 sounds very good, but there are 4 and 5. 4, execute the render loop until the user wants to stop. Maybe he's sick or something like that. And step 5 is clean up your mess. So let's take a look at the API, how it is nowadays. They may change. It's a bit different to web VR. We have this XR object on our navigator, not object, method or function, and we could request a device. And if we found a device, we are executing a callback with this device we've found. If not, we could have some error handling and so on. When we found a device, the callback is called, and I'm saving this device in this variable for global usage. And now I test if this device supports the desired session type. Immersive, true, means I want a VR session. At the beginning of the Web XR rollout, they will support mainly VR, and AR is they think about AR, and if they support AR, they will support tracker-based AR. So if we got this device with the desired session, we are creating an enter button, and if the user clicks the enter button, we are calling our to begin the session. We are executing our function and begin the session. We request the session again, and start the session finally. What we are doing here is, when there's something wrong, I provide a fallback. So I could render in a canvas on the desktop screen. So you could also see, this is a bit of progressive enhancement. So if he's not able to, okay, I show him this, what he's able to see. And when we've got the session, we get the frame reference, and we're starting our render loop. So if you see, you have a request animation frame on our XR session. So the new API does not rely on the rendering on your PC or the animation frame on the PC. It uses the animation frame your attached device provides. So you have better FPS, and you are able to render different different views for the host screen or for the device itself. Or when you think about the Magic Leap, they have other rendering loops as my PC. Step 3, the render loop. We are checking the compatibility, if we are WebGL compatible, our device. And then we start, then we show new base layer. Number 4, we draw a scene. Now it's getting interesting, because now we could see if this, this device has different views. So for every view I got, so when we've head-mounted display, we have 2 views, left eye, right eye. It passes the pose sensor for this view and the view itself. If not, I can draw the scene without any XR support. Let's take a look at the draw scene. If we've got a view, we are using it. So we get the view matrix for the matrix transformation, for the rendering from our scene, for the different eyes. And then we draw the scene. If we don't have the view, we only draw the scene, because we don't have to take care of it. So as you see, we get support to render the right things for the eyes. We don't have to think about the mathematics to render it itself for us, like it was in WebVR. And step 5, clean up. When your session is being ended, just clean your stuff. That's all. What you could provide is a rendering on your screen that you could say, okay, this is what you had experienced or what you can play with, or you could start it again. Just the fallback. You don't have to do it. But there's many, 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 many more. It's just the tip of an iceberg. We have things like mirroring. We have active support to mirror things the user sees on a on the host device, computer or something like that. We have support for magic windows. Magic windows are those views in VR which are on the browser. So you could experience with just 3D without your headset. We have support for input handling. In WebVR, we should use the Gamepad API. Now WebXR gets dedicated input handling for touch, for those controllers like HTC Vive or Oculus Rift, and all those possibilities we have to interact with the scene. We're getting room tracking, as told. When they are going to AR, they have room tracking. And there's so many, many more things which are planned. And you can find more information on the GitHub organization, the Immersive Web, and the WebXR. There's also a detailed document what the Immersive Web should be in W3C's eyes. If you want to play with it, as I said, this is just beta. There are two apps or three apps when you want to play with these AR features which are proposed. There is the Mozilla XR Viewer. You can download it for iOS. And you have capabilities of ARKit and accessible by JavaScript with these APIs which are proposed. You have web on this is great. Web AR on AR Core from Google. When you want to experience these things with Android, it's just basically a browser with some more APIs. And we have web ER on AR Kit, also from Google. And we have a framework. There is a fork of A-Frame which supports XR, and which supports XR in this browser. So if you're installing these web or these XR viewer from Mozilla, you're already on a landing page where you see many, many examples how they use it with tracking, with room tracking, and so on. That's amazing. That's maybe it's a great API if it's sometimes ready. We have A-Frame XR where you have this A-Painter in augmented reality, for example, where you can play with. So you can paint. You can create a painting of this VR fox in the room now. And it's pretty easy to use because what they say is, okay, we have a new attribute and say, okay, when I've got an AR, when I am in the AR modus, draw this thing. When we are in VR, don't draw this thing, and so on. So we could decide when we are creating an experience if what we want to see in the different immersive modes. Like this. So here we've got no ball there, so, or you couldn't render this base, I don't know, this shape under your 3D objects when you are in AR mode, because you have your floor. What are the advantages? Why I'm talking about WebXR? That's easy because it's progressive. So we have one code for different experiences. This is VR view. This is the magic window. This is the VR view. And this is actually footage from my garden. And I don't have this plane under these things. So you could create one app which is being displayed on different devices or different modes, and with PWAs you could make them installable and offline capable. That's a great game changer because you don't have to be in any app store or something like that. So there are no gatekeepers. There's nobody who says, oh no, this experience is not suitable for your device, because I want that you buy my device and use only this. So we have no gatekeepers. It's web, it's standards, it's open. Everybody could see it, everybody could develop. It's instant. So you're giving a link, you're opening it. If your connection is okay, you could see your experience without installing a Steam client or something like that. Or you have to update some Steam clients before you could download your app you want to see, you want to use to see a VR experience. They are connected. If you think that's great, you need to look at it. You're sending a link, that's all. You don't have to check if the GPU is capable or if the user is using Windows or Mac. You're sending a link. It's a browser. Everyone has a browser, even on its smartphone. And it's open. It's an open standard. It's open development. The web is open. And there is no closed ecosystem. The web is the ecosystem, the browser is the runtime. That's all. And it's developed by a community. It's not just one vendor. It's the community. It's Google, it's Mozilla, it's Apple. They are developing it together, the whole APIs, the whole standards. That's great. That's what the web, what's the core of the web. Do not use closed system, use this open system. It's not capable for 3D games or something like that. I think this is still a thing which is only capable for native devices, native apps. But for marketing stuff, for example, or like this 3D viewer of the interior design of a Ford SUV, it's great. Or you could experience a car, you could put a car into the room and it could walk around. You don't need a native app. You could do it with WebXR. The problem is WebXR will not be ready soon. They just started to develop these APIs. So that's mainly the biggest problem, I think. And as we know, a new standard needs time to be in every browser. We needed about 5 years or more until Apple Safari supports service workers. So I don't expect that this will be here soon. But anyway, you could go out and create some awesome WebXR stuff. My recommendation is using A-Frame, because it's easy to learn, hard to master, because under A-Frame there is 3JS, the framework, the WebGL framework, and you could do anything what 3JS is able to do. But if you want to create little experiences, it's pretty perfect. Go and check out those XR viewer apps or something to see what the web is capable to do when the standard is arriving, because it's really amazing that a web browser is able to detect my planes and so on. So let's see if it's happening. I don't think it's getting soon. That's all from me. I would like to thank you. And if you have any questions, go for it. Okay, the question is how, correct me when I'm wrong, how WebVR will help for the adaption of VR itself. Okay, it's a hard question, because WebVR on its own has its problem with an adaption. I think it's going down again, and I don't think that WebVR will help to get the adaption. You have another runtime with your browser to show VR experience, but the most people who think about VR think about great games and shock effects and so on. I don't think that web VR will generate this, but it will. Yeah, it will help us to create better things or little things in internet or a web browser to show some something new. Marketing, what I've told before, marketing things like you're sending your customer Google Cardboard with a link, and he could see this. But I don't think this will help the web, the VR itself to get more traction. More questions? Yeah. Yeah, that's a good question. What about WebAssembly? Yes, that's a good question. There is a plugin for Unity from Mozilla, which generates your VR app as a web VR experience using WebAssembly. So WebAssembly allows us to cross-compile other languages into something JavaScript-ish. It's not really JavaScript. I think this is a good way to have more performance on the internet. The problem is you still don't know what power the machine has you are using at the moment. So if you are deploying a game or something really complex, you still have megabytes of assets and so on. And I think this is a problem for web VR because you don't know if it's a smartphone and it's on a metered plan or something like that. But it's still in development, and it will help to have more performant VR apps. Yes. Any other question? No? So you're released. That's it. So have a nice evening and see you this evening.